Praise God. I greet you from a warm, sunny Tanzania to a cold, cold, cold. You know, I love the cold, and I longed for the cold now and then. It sounds weird. But when I came here, my body had a shock, young, because I got cold. And believe it or not, I'm cold now. So I got all this layers of stuff on here. So I'm feeling warm now. Amen. That's good. It's good to feel warm, eh? But I'm a warm person. That helps a lot. I'm a very warm person. Praise God. There was this conference once, and they had all these different guest speakers, and they invited they introduced all the guest speakers for the week. And what they did was they read all the accolades type of thing, and all the degrees, and you know, what they acquired and what they achieved. And they came to this one person, and all they said is, he's a very warm person. They didn't say he's got so many degrees and you know, da-da, just a warm person. So he felt very bad and cut up about the whole thing, you know. And so he went home and he looked in the dictionary, and it says there, a very warm person, I mean, warm means not so hot. Amen. Praise the Lord. I'm excited to be here. Do you love Jesus?
Amen.
Praise God. I just want him to put a scripture on the screen. Psalms 107 verse 14. Psalms 107 verse 14, please. Could they do that? And then I need just one gentleman that has muscle. Just to come, please. I need to ask him a favor. I need a gentleman with a muscle. Let's see who's confident. I need a gentleman with muscle. I would have used myself, but I thought, no, that's not going to be good. I need to use a gentleman. Ah, okay. Yes, Monet. Okay, I just need to ask him. Just hold on. Can you put, yeah, that scripture's on there? Okay. Look at that scripture while I just speak to him. Thank you. Okay, now it says there, Psalms 107 verse 14, it says, he led them from the darkness and deepest gloom. He snapped their chains. Amen? He led them from the darkness and deepest gloom, and he snapped their chains. Now, I had an old auntie. I think she passed away already, but she used to be very scriptural, you know. And she always loved the word gloom. The gloominess and gloom, and she used the word gloom all the time. And I tried to encourage this auntie and say, please, auntie, can you be a bit positive too, man? Because that sounds so negative. She said, no, it's a spiritual word, you know. But eventually, I think God changed her and touched her, and she's got the joy. And she changed from using the word gloom, and she used the word happiness and joy. Amen. Thank you, brother. Okay, I want you to put it down here if it's okay. Thanks, Monet. Monet's my brother-in-law, basically. Brother-in-law's brother, if you can put it that way. Amen. Okay, now, you know, I've got a small little chain here. My sister, I somehow took it from a closet. she will still love me for this. I promise I'm not going to break it, but this is a little chain. You know, you get thinner chains. You can see there's a little thin chain attached to this chain. And this chain, you know, they always say the chain is as strong as the weakest link. So if there is a weak link on this chain, if I pull, right, if I try and pull this thing apart, it's quite firm. But I apply all my strength and I pull this thing with all of my might, I most probably will break this chain. But the weakest link, if there's a crack somewhere or whatever, it will break there first and I will snap the whole chain. But I won't do that because I'm a very loving brother-in-law. So sometimes the enemy comes with chains in our lives and he binds us. Isn't it amazing that he binds us? He comes with small chains first. And those are things that you can easily snap, you know. And many people even have the attitude or they say, I've got a smoking habit, but I can break it easily because it's a small habit. But if that thing becomes, that thing doesn't stay the same, by the way. Every habit that we have, it actually grows. Every addiction that we have, it actually grows and it becomes stronger and stronger. It becomes more firmer. That's why we have strongholds. But listen, I need to explain this. You see this chain? It's a small little chain. Ach, it's easy to snap this. But I'm a good brother-in-law. And then, there's quite different sizes. You get different sizes of chains. Amen. There's someone's dog that's happy tonight. He's singing that song. I'm free, free as a dove. Okay, so my neighbor's chain, you know. I didn't bring this from Tanzania, guys, please. My neighbor's chain. I promise him I'm going to give it back tonight. You see, this chain is quite a bit stronger. And Pastor Greg, can I ask you to come here, please? Now, this chain is definitely much stronger than that chain. Now, I have confidence that you won't break this chain. I can see you've got muscle, but I don't think. Can you try and like break this chain? Pull it apart if you can try that. I want the people to see. You must show your might with all of your might. Can you try? You can't. Can you stay here, sir? You don't mind? Monet, can you also come here? He's a strong guy. The two of you. Can you, the two of you together, try and just like try and snap this chain? Nah. No, you guys can't. Okay, stay here, guys. Stay here, guys. Okay, I need two more guys this side. Please come here. Come join Pastor Greg. I need two more guys this side to come join Monet. Please, I need you guys. Are strong. I know that. You guys in PE, you're very strong. Come, please. Two guys. Any two guys? Yes, come, my brother. There's my brother coming. Big guys are coming here. I'm getting a bit nervous. I hope this chain will last. I'm going to have a very unhappy neighbor if you guys break this chain. But you can try and break it. I'll buy him another one. It's okay. My brother, yes, can you come this side? Because I see this one there. I asked for two guys. Where's the other two guys? Come, brother. I need another brother. There's a lot of big guys in this church. Come on, guys. I hear the name Clive. Clive. Come, Clive. You can stand this side, yeah. Clive, are you... You got a fiancé? Yeah. Oh, okay. No, he's got all the energy now. Okay, so... Okay, now, can you guys put all your hands to this chain somehow? And just try and snap this chain. Come, don't hurt yourselves, but... You know, hurt the chain, man. Okay. Don't hurt yourselves, eh? Can you try and pull it again? Try again, come. Okay, just do it together. I'm going to count to three. I'm going to count to three. I'm going to ask you guys to go. Then you go for it, okay? Catch your breath. Catch your breath. Guys, now you must act macho. Your wives are watching, okay? One, two, three. Count. Do it. Nah. Pastor Jimmy, these guys are tough guys, but they cannot even break that chain. Thank you, guys. Thank you, guys. As you can see, this chain is very strong. And I'm sure there's a weak link somewhere, yeah? But the problem is to find that weak link is quite a story. And it's going to be quite a story to actually break this chain. But I think if these guys persist, if they do this every day for 365 days, the whole year, I'm sure something can happen, eh? You see, I'm encouraging you guys still. In all of this hardship, there's still encouragement, there's still hope, guys. So that's what happens, you see. The devil first comes with temptations and we fall for that. And then afterwards we just do it. We entertain that thought that comes into our mind. Because thoughts comes, the devil attacks your thoughts. Do you know what? That he starts to attack your mind. And they done a survey and they said that one guy done the survey, one professional, some psychologist guy done the survey. And he said the average, you can see all the chains there. He said the average person... will think 50,000 to 60,000 thoughts a day will go through your mind. And then this other psychologist again somehow disagreed with this first one that I said, and he said, no, it's 70,000 to 80,000 thoughts a day. But I'm going to be conservative and stick with 50,000. Is that okay? Okay. 50,000. No? Don't you guys think that most of these thoughts are nonsense? And then they say as well, if we start to streamline our thinking and we start to focus our thoughts and we have purpose, then we'll start to decipher and we'll start to cut out all the negative thoughts. And we'll start to be more focused, they say. And then they say, so then I've done this research, another survey, I always like to say this at weddings, another survey, they prove that a man speaks 5,000 words a day. And then they say a woman speaks 10,000 words a day. Pastor Jimmy, Pastor Mariana, we've seen that in many ladies' lives, eh? I know. But I know some of you men are above average. And you look and buy a prat, my young. Oh, my Lord. When some people come to me and my wife already, I say to my wife, verbal diarrhea. I ask my wife, check, please. We've got 5 minutes to go, you know. And these people will talk and talk on one, eh? You'll think they're on steroids or something, but anyway. So if you think about it, so let's be conservative. 10% of what you, everything that you think, 50,000, 10% of that you speak. Interesting, eh? Okay, that's what I discovered. Hey! I didn't hear these guys say that, but I just assumed that. So if we speak 10% of what we think, that means we must watch what we think and streamline our thinking. Instead of allowing negative thoughts to take root in our minds, our soul, we just start thinking about those thoughts. And that's why I love to spend time in God's Word. And I love to meditate on Scripture. If I have a lot of time, I meditate on Scripture. And I go into the Word. I think of those Scriptures. I live myself in. That's why I like the dramatized thing and illustrative stuff. Because I'm living myself in it. What would Jesus do if I was there? And if I was that guy? And if I was this guy? And how would Jesus have handled that situation? What would I have done back in the day? So I'm thinking of Scripture all the time. And that's what we need to do. Then I notice my life becomes more focused. I become more effective and more anointed in what I do. The power of the devil, the power of Satan cannot get hold of me because I'm grounded in the Word. And I'm more streamlined in my thinking. And I'm more focused in my thoughts. Because if you allow the devil to play with your mind, guess what's going to happen? He's going to throw all these negative thoughts at you. And one negative thought, if you start to entertain one little thought that's not of God, it's going to grow. It's going to bind you. And that thought is going to grow into a thicker chain. And it's going to grow. And it's going to bind you to such a degree that you won't be able to just get set free. Yes, it will take the Holy Spirit to set you free. But you need to yield to the Holy Ghost 100%. And your deliverance will become much more intensive. Now in Tanzania, before I came, they were busy with the deliverance. Where's Pastor James? He would love this. They were busy with the deliverance and they were busy delivering this guy. But they're trying to deliver this guy for 5 years. This guy stanked up with demons. It started off with a little thought of sexual immorality. He started watching porno on the internet. And now it's becoming quite a thing amongst the young people in Tanzania. So the guys are into pornography big time. There's a lot of demons there. You know? So this guy started watching something on the internet. And he started to entertain those thoughts. And he started to fantasize in his mind. And then he allowed that thing to take root in his mind. So he thought he can get rid of it, but that thing just entertained those thoughts. Then it became a little chain. And then that thing took root and became even a stronger chain, like I showed you. And that thing became much stronger in his life. And then guess what happened? Satan did not just have a hold on his mind. Satan then eventually had a stronghold on his mind. You see, Satan can have a hold on your mind if you don't surrender to God. And then Satan will eventually have a strong hold on you. You know how Satan had a strong hold on him? Because he started to watch pornographic stuff all the time. He started to watch it all the time. And then eventually started to sleep with girls. Can you see what happens? The one thing leads to the other thing. There's a build up on the inside. And then there's a manifestation of perversion. You start to do something of what started and began as a thought. It progresses. The devil doesn't just leave that thing there. Okay, he's got a habit. I've got him. Lekker. No. That thing grows and takes root and becomes stronger. The chain grows. In the spiritual realm, it grows. And the chain becomes stronger. The hold becomes stronger. And stronger and stronger and stronger. Luke 11:26 says, you can put that scripture up. Luke 11:26 says, it says from verse 24 till verse 26. It says that when a demon leaves a home, signifying us, because we're the temple of God, when the spirit finds seven others. Go to 24 leading up to 26. Okay, let's look at verse 24. When an evil spirit leaves a person, it goes into the desert, searching for rest. But when it finds none, it says, I will return to the person I came from. Go to the next verse, 25. So it returns and finds that its former home is all swept and in order. Verse 26. Then the spirit finds seven other demons, more evil than itself. And they all enter the person and live there. And so that person is worse off than before. In other words, I'm saying that chain becomes stronger seven times. Now look at this. Woo, baby! Woo! This thing weighs 50 kgs. The size of a cement bag. Shit, I told you I'm strong. Can you see this link? This is basically a quarter of a link. I got from the oil rigs, the NP. That new oil rig that came there. Yeah. One of the guys working there, I asked him, please bring me a link. I want to show these people what I'm talking about. This thing is heavy. Ay, ik is sterk nog. Pastor Jimmy, I got it nog. Amen. Oh, my wife is going to be impressed. Video me, I'm going to show her. Look here. This is for you, baby. This is for you, baby. Yes, I can do it. I can do it. Okay. Okay. My mother-in-law needs to rub my arm tonight. Okay. Listen. Can you see how thick that thing becomes? That's a quarter of a link. Those are the chains they use to you know, the oil rigs, they throw it down as anchors there. And there's an anchor attached to it. That thing is in that seawater. I mean, it's massive. And it's heavy. I'm looking so... I'm carrying it like it's light, but I'm a strong guy, so we must understand. This thing is heavy. Marlene, just come here, please, if you don't mind. Just come here. These guys don't believe me. Come here, Marlene. Don't pick it up. You're going to hurt your back, but just try and feel how heavy it is. Just with both your hands, both your arms. I know you're a strong woman, but I don't want you to show off, yeah? Because I don't want the men to be scared, man. Listen, I want you to get married still, my sister. Okay. It's heavy, eh?
Okay.
This woman is a strong woman. But you can feel it's heavy.
I can feel it's heavy.
Size of a cement bag.
Mm.
Can you pick up a cement bag?
No.
You can't? But that's the size of a cement bag. Yeah, but cement bag is difficult to get hold of. I know, yeah. But you're a good woman. Thank you. Thank you. This thing is heavy. So imagine a long chain. Now, this is what the devil does. Listen, there's chains bigger than this too. This little baby. But this is to blow your thinking a bit tonight. Now, this is what the devil does. He starts off with a small little chain. He comes with a bigger one. And then it grows. One demon, they leave the person. That person gets set free, but the person does not make Jesus Lord. So the demons come back and they bring all their buddies. Hey, when you go to a party, you don't go party alone. You party with your buddies. That's what the demons do. They bring all their demons. And they come in seven times. Another translation says seven times stronger. They come into you. Which means the problems you had before, you're having that seven times more intensified. So what am I trying to say? I'm saying to you that if you had a problem years ago, I got some feedback here. When you have problems years ago and you never dealt with it, my sister, my brother, that thing is not going to stay the same. That thing is going to intensify and grow and become stronger and kill and destroy you. Because Satan's assignment is to destroy your life. You see, God always has an assignment for you. But Satan has a counter assignment. And he wants to kill and destroy your life. So it makes sense. You cannot be addicted to cigarettes and nicotine all your life and still live. There's going to come a time where he's going to take you out. Amen. Actually, don't say amen. If you're struggling with cigarettes, say, oh, me. Yeah, that's what happens. So, that demon comes and brings seven others. Now, when it says seven others, just because of my experience I had with people and stuff like that, it doesn't mean it will be seven of the same problem. It can be seven of other problems because demons are linked to each other. Fear is always linked, for example, to fear can be linked to anger as well and even to depression and all those type of things. There's different demons, deception. Deception is always linked to fear. Because the devil deceives you to believe something, it's not the truth. You see, so the demons are always like linked to something else. And that's what the devil wants to do, to destroy your life. But I'm not here to preach about Satan. I'm here to preach about the freedom that Jesus can give you.
Amen.
Okay? But I'm here to expose the devil. Amen? So this guy was struggling for, they struggled for 5 years, trying to cast the demons out of him. And all the Tanzanian pastors, most of them, they're not all that, most of them came and they prayed for this guy. And the way they guys do deal with demons there is the same the way many of us deal with demons this side in South Africa, you know. Although we more clued up here in Word of Faith, and this church is on the cutting edge, it's a blueprint church. So we mile streaks ahead, actually, of many churches. That's why we've got tools to offer to many churches. That's why I'm in Tanzania, to take what we have here there. Amen. So these pastors would come. And they would actually take this guy to the pastors. And they actually took them to the churches. And the churches would stop with what they're doing. And they would just focus on that guy. And they would pray at the top of their voices in tongues. Pray, and the guy would throw up and do funny things and manifest and shake and da-da-da-da. And these pastors think, okay, they're getting set free. But they're still doing the same thing all night long, you know, 3 hours. Then the guys are tired. They leave church late. Next morning, again to another church, they're praying for 3 hours, fast and pray, nothing happening. Guy shaking, throwing up and doing his thing, nothing's happening. The guy's still like the same before. Then they take him to another church down the road. The missionary is there. The school we're taking our kids to, it's a missionary, missionaries founded that school. So now they give nice discounts to all the missionaries. That's why our kids are there, praise God. You know, it's $14,000 per child for the year. We don't pay that. We only pay $500 for the child for the year. So God is good, amen. So we took him, then all these missionaries, quite a massive, many establishments, missionaries from America, from all over the show. And these guys are there, but these guys are well-established financially, well-established with their knowledge and all that. But the thing is, they're not equipped for spiritually. They don't even know how to deal with these issues. I'm not knocking them, but I'm just saying that's just how it is, you know. That's why God has placed us there to help. So these guys also got involved because one of the children in school, it's his cousin, that's now tanked up with demons, and they're all involved as well. And they took him to the mission. The missionaries prayed for hours, nothing happening. They're tired. You know what the devil does? He wants to take your focus off your family. Because this one woman, she spent hours trying to pray also with these people, trying to help this guy because he's compassionate. But it almost messed up her marriage. That's what the devil wants to do. You're praying for hours with this guy and nothing is happening. You're praying for hours with this guy and nothing is happening. But yet, you're actually losing your focus and you're not doing it the right way. But you're forgetting about your family. So these missionaries are phoning me in a panic. And I just came from another church. We're in the car traveling back. And my wife and us late at night. And they're panicking on the phone. Say, Pastor D, we heard you also do this. Pray for people that has demons. Can you please help us, man? Help us. We're panicking. We don't know what to do. We're for hours and hours praying. And I had to calm them down on the phone. And said, relax. Relax, guys. The devil is wanting you to run around and panic. You need to relax. Hang on. Go home and sleep and find your rest. Because but you want to pray the whole night. This thing is urgent. No. You're not going to have a family left, my sister. Go back to your husband and your family and rest with them. And I will come see you guys later morning. I'll come see you guys there. How long did they have this demon problem? 5 years. I said, I can wait for 5 more hours. Amen. Let's sleep and we can see them in the morning. Amen. So she did that. And guess what? The husband came to me and said, "Ooh, hey, man, thank you. You just helped my marriage, man, you know." But anyway, we went there, went to this person, and then we looked at this person. I said to him, "What happened?" And we first sat this guy down, spoke to him, had a session with him, asked him, "What's the problem?" And he opened up, shared his heart, counseled the guy, first found what is the root problems, how did these doors open up. And then he told me it happened, you know, 5 years ago. This is what happened. I said, "Okay. Did anybody, any of these pastors talk to you about it?" "No." "What did you know?" "They just came to pray." "Okay. I'm talking to you now, because that's what we need to do. Find out what's the root issues, you know. And I'm not going to pray with you today, and I'm just going to talk to you. I'll pray with you next time." "Huh?" So all the pastors look at me, "What?" I said, "Yeah." So I talked to that guy, 40 minutes, found out the root issues. Okay, got him to repent, close the doors. Said, "I'll see you tomorrow again." I done it purposefully. I want these pastors to see it's not your strength, it's in God's ability. Amen. Anyway, so these pastors said they've never seen this, a Tanzanian pastor. "Why are you doing it so different? But you seem to get results because the guy is not manifesting and he's not like running on and doing his thing." I said, "Don't worry, tomorrow we're going to pray. You will see all that happen quickly. This will be a long story." Like Pastor Jimmy said, I like what he taught to the pastors. He said, find out the legal right and Strip the devil of the legal right, and then you cast him out. Amen. Next day, went there. All the pastors want to see this now. He's just for real, you know. All standing there, and I'm saying, God, you just teach these people. Teach them, show them that we're ignorant at times. Amen. So I said to the guy, okay, you ready? In actual fact, he came to my place. I said, you come to my place. These people are desperate. You don't run after them. They must come to you. Okay. I know some people don't want to do it in their homes, but that's okay. So they came to my place, and we all came there. I said to him, okay, let's pray. Prayed. Commanded demons of God. He manifested. Demons screamed out of him. He got delivered. 1, 2, 3. It was over. And then I looked at him, and he said to me, I need one more thing. I said, what? I want to speak in tongues. I said, okay. Yes, the demons are out. Now we need to replace it with something. Because now you emptied and cleaned up. But now you need the Holy Spirit to come and fill you up again. So I said, okay, we're going to pray for the Holy Spirit to fill you up. And then I was about to get up, because normally I like to lay hands when I pray for the Holy Spirit to fill somebody, you know. And I got up, and as I got up, the guy spoke in tongues. And I said, Holy Spirit, you didn't even wait for me. And the Holy Spirit says, no. You wait for me, I don't wait for you. I said, okay. So the guy spoke in tongues. In actual fact, he screamed in tongues. Then he got so excited. All the pastors there, they're sitting there going, oh my, this is the first time we see this. This guy doesn't even take hours like we do. You know, and I was sitting there with my shorty and I was doing it. And he's with his shorts on. And they were their church clothing on. This guy's with his shorts on and he just speaks with authority and the demons come. I said, hey, it's not you. It's what's inside of you. Amen. And so this guy got set free, delivered, spoke in other tongues. And I asked him, I tried to calm him down after a few minutes. I said, listen, how do you feel? He said, Pastor, I'm good. I said, how are you feeling, brother? Oh, I'm feeling good. Hey, the people. And they all got excited. The family was there. The family started breaking down and weeping. And they started weeping and the power of God touched them. And they even got set free. And God touched them supernaturally. And these pastors were sitting down and they were amazed. And I said to them, you see, God can do it. But we need to first talk to these people, guys. You know? Sometimes our cultures get in the way. There's nothing wrong with cultures. There's some nice things about our traditions that I love. But there are some things that are against the kingdom of God. You see, when you get born again, it's no longer your culture and my culture. It's a kingdom culture. There's certain things we do still. Yes, I understand. But like the colored people like to eat their big meals on a Sunday afternoon. Don't look at me like that. I know because I'm also colored. I also eat big meals. And so obviously I'm now here with my mother-in-law and she's now spoiling me. You know, we've got these big meals there. So I'm eating them. I'm sending pictures to my wife. And I say, yummy. But she's stay coming also at the end of the month. So I'm excited. And then all of you got different cultures. But if it gets in the way of God's culture, then it's a problem. You see, we all have a kingdom culture. That's what unites us. Amen? Jesus, he unites us together. So you find that God sets us free. But you've got to get that person filled and baptized in the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. And God can do it supernaturally. You're not doing it. Jesus is the baptizer. But you've got to get them filled again. If you don't get them filled with Jesus, then that becomes a problem. You see, the problem is many of us Christians, Jesus only remains our Savior, but he doesn't become our Lord. We don't take the next step. And when he's your Savior, we say, Jesus, forgive me of my sin. Come and live inside of me. He comes and forgives you. He comes inside of you. But you don't take the next step. When you say, Jesus, become my Lord, you're saying, Jesus, I give you everything. I surrender everything to you. Even the chains and shackles that's on my life, come and break it, Lord. I surrender all those shackles. All those negative words that I've been speaking, that 10% of all that filthy thoughts that I've been entertaining. Lord, I'm cutting it off today. I surrender that to you. Come and cover me, wash me with the blood, my mind and my words. And come and cut these chains off me. Like this link was cut off, you can see it. Huh? It was cut off. So God, the power of God, the Holy Ghost wants to cut off every link that the enemy has placed in your life. Now, this one Christian challenged me once and he said, how can Christians have demons? I just challenged them with one question back, one answer back. I said, why do Christians have so many problems? He was quiet. I even asked him, why do you have many problems? He said, okay, you got a point. I said, does the Holy Spirit give you problems? No, the devil. Let's not call all these medical terms nice names, eh? We're calling demons nice names, yeah. A spade is a spade. Amen? Yeah. A spade is a spade. Don't tell me, no, I'm transgender, or I'm this, and I'm, yeah. There's a lot of these words with all these sexual disorders. People don't know their identity. So there's a lot of these names that I was shocked. I was doing some research because I meet a lot of them even there. So let's not call it nice names. No, it's just how I am, you know. I'm a transgender, yeah. Yes, no. I just put on women's clothes in the evenings, yeah. Yeah, yeah, man, my mother's fitting me. My clothes fit me too, yeah. Okay, that's why I walk and talk like this, you see. I'm okay. I'm normal. You know what? God really protected me from that. Because when I was a child, my hair, they used to tease me pretty cut. And my hair used to grow out like this. All over my face, like Mercedes. I don't know if you know my daughter. You saw my daughter. She was very small, very petite. And her hair came out like this all over, like pretty cut. They used to call me as well like that. And then I remember so, when we went to some family. And my cousins were much older than me. They used to play with me and tie my hair up and put some ribbons on it. And they used to like tease me, you know. Hey, Pastor, what are you talking now in the pulpit? Are you really embarrassing yourself? No. I don't need to worry about those things because I know who I am, man. If you're going to worry, I'll pray for you also. Amen. If you've got issues with your gender, I'll pray for you. Amen. We'll kick the other one out and we'll keep you. Amen. So, we love transgenders. We love homosexuals. We love all these people. We just hate the sin, baby. We just hate the chains. You see, we want to take the chains off you so that you can know who you are. It must be stressed out, eh? Being one and two and three different people. You don't know if you're Arthur or Martha, man. Okay, you're Arthur certain times and Martha certain times. Amen. You're laughing about it, but some people struggle with these issues. You see, you think it's normal. You think you were born like that. Because you thought that God made Adam and Steve. But God made Adam and Eve. Amen. Praise God. Yeah. So God wants to deliver us and set us free. We just love you. You just got issues there. So God wants to set you free totally in that area. So it just depends on you. You have to surrender to Him and yield to Him 100%. Because it takes the power of God and the blood of Jesus to set you free totally. Now, I'm looking at the time and I don't want to go over time. I need to end soon because we need to pray for people and minister healing to people and set people free here in this place. Amen. God is in this place. Tell the person next to you, God's in this place. Amen. Now, just look at this. Look at Mark 3 verse 27. Look at Mark 3 verse 27. Mark chapter 3 verse 27. Give the guys a hand behind the computer box there. They're doing a good job. They're doing a great job. Great job. Okay. Let me just finish that story. And then I was, and they should put these ribbons around my hair. And then I look like a girl, you know. Because I mean, I had a pretty face, you know. Girls have pretty faces. But I had a pretty face as a child. I mean, many of these boys, they have pretty faces, you know. And I'm not vain. It's the truth, man. I can show you some photos to Mercedes. Her face is exactly like mine when I was small. And Jordan's face is exactly like her mom when she was small. And so they used to tease me and put this thing and call me purdy cut. So if you think about this, if you think about it, I could have ended up going that way. But I must be honest with you, I did not in my entire lifetime, I did not have the slightest temptation to wear women's clothing. Or I wasn't attracted to another man. Although another man challenged me once, a homosexual came up to me. And he said to me, I dare you to kiss me. Ek sê vir julle, was julle nie 5 o'clock service? Ding het uitgekom, jong. Hey, dit was soppige nuus, jong. Yo, die stories wat daar uitgekom het, julle. Excuse me, guys, I have an outburst of Afrikaans now and then. Because I never, Afrikaans is extinct in Tanzania. We don't talk Afrikaans there. In actual fact, I heard one missionary fluke another person in Afrikaans. And I heard they was like from South Africa. And I said, ek weet wat jy gesê het. Woo, jammer. Ek bekeer. He said, watch out, you never know who the person, what the person speaks. Yeah, this guy came up to me. And he said to me, I dare you to kiss me. I look at him and said, listen, I'm not even tempted to listen to you. Just get away from me, man. And I just walked away. That's all I could say. It's like saying, get away from me, Satan, you know. I said, get away from me, brother. Can't even call him brother. At least it's from another mother. Listen, we love those type of guys, but we just hate the sin, man. But there's sometimes you have to run. Amen? Run. So God protected me that I was never tempted to be attracted to another man, to kiss another man, to have an affair with another man, or to even think in those lines. You understand what I'm saying? So God is gracious. If I was tempted, I would have been open and I would have gone for help. Amen? And if there are people here that are tempted, oh no, drug ek op nommer si so jong. Yay. And if there are people here that are tempted, listen, if I was tempted, I wouldn't have been ashamed. I would have gone for help and get over it and get my deliverance. So if there's people here that's struggling, both sexes, both your woman or man, and you're inclined to be, somehow you're attracted, you tend to be attracted to the opposite sex or the same, not opposite, the same sex. But the opposite sex is a good thing, you know, if you're single, it's good. Get a man if you're a woman, please. Get a woman if you're a man. But if you're attracted to the same sex, this is a reality to many people, and I'm not joking now. I know it's an issue. You've got to get help. You can't do this on your own. Get to the pastors, get to the leaders, and say, listen, we need help. Can you please help deliver us and set us free? And I had a homosexual guy that stayed with us in our home for 5 years by the name of Romeo Callis. It was years ago, he was murdered, as you know. Some of you know the story, those of you have been here for long. Some of you new people don't even know what I'm talking about. But just act as if you know. So this guy was a young guy. We were like the surrogate parents, they say, you know. Even in newspapers, they put it there. It was a big write-up of his murder. And it was a very sad story because we loved this guy. But he was not a homosexual by choice. He was abused sexually when he was a young boy. And he was constantly raped and abused. And that's how he became a homosexual, because of the abuse. And the demons put these chains on him and these shackles on him. He had demons 7 times stronger. Because countless times he repented, but he fell back into the same trap. And the demons came 7 times stronger. The guy was so tanked up with demons that when we were at the camp, and my wife, God said to her at the same time, we just got married for a month, eh? And God said to my wife, when you're married, you've got to stay on your own for a while just to get used to your wife and your husband. And just, that's healthier, you know. But to us, it was a different ball game. God said to my wife, that guy, you must take him in as your son. But believe me, God told me the same time, he told her, like, that boy you must take in as your son. And I thought, okay, this must be from the devil. Because we just got married. Hello. There goes our honeymoon time now. For 26 years I was a virgin. And now, my honeymoon time gets taken away. Serious, I was a virgin for 26 years and I got married. As a 26-year-old man, God kept me. I'm not better than the guys that broke their virginity. Amen? But listen. So we took this guy in. I spoke to Renee and I said, Denver, God spoke to me. I said, yes, it's confirmation. Let's take this guy in. Let's teach him about boundaries. Amen? We need to have our time as well, you know? But we stayed in this place. There are 2 bedrooms. He stayed in the 1 bedroom and we helped coach this guy and mentored him. He was very uncomfortable around me. He couldn't even hug me. Very uncomfortable, you know? Obviously, he was abused by the opposites, by the same sex. So he couldn't, like, relate to me as a father. So it took a while until he turned 21. And then he took me as a father. On his 21st birthday, the year before he got murdered. Ask Pastor Jim and Marion, this man could sing heaven down. Eh? Still up till today, I never heard a singer like him yet, you know? In the church, he sang. Eh? Anyway, So we on his 21st birthday, he hugged me tight and he held me tight. So I thought, yeah, this is something new. And I just loved on him. And I just showered love because the love I showed him was different than the love he was used to. Because it was enforced on him and he was abused and sexually, you know, he was always taken advantage of. Like when the guys would give him something nice and he knew there's sex coming, you know, they're going to force him. But with me, I gave him something nice and I said, I love you, God loves you with no strings attached, unconditional love. And it's a love of God that sets him free. And God set him free. And normally they say most cases the root issue is if a man has grown up with a gap left inside of him by his father, he will try and fill that gap with relationships with other men in a perverse manner. If a woman has a gap inside of her, left by her mom, she will try and fill that gap by having relationships with other women. And I experienced that with people that I counseled and saw throughout our lifetime. We counseled quite a few people that was walking with, that was struggling with homosexuality. So we really have a passion for those people. And we walk with them and we help them. You know, over the years I've realized that I didn't even notice it. And I see God just sets them free. Because it's a difficult situation, you know. People don't normally believe in them and people just write them off. But we just love them and just walk with them through the thing. You have to have your boundaries in place as well. But Romeo, I believe he got set free. He got delivered and set free on his 21st. I mean, that year, it was powerful. Awesome to see how God broke the chains in his life. All those demons left him and he got set free. It was wonderful to see how he started ministering to other folks struggling with the same thing, with the same problem, also homosexuality. And to see how God got them out of it. I mean, he tried to minister into their lives and I could see God doing something in their lives. He referred them to church. That's what God did. Amen. Sometimes a difficult thing to get out of it in the natural because the chain has grown this thick, the link has gone this thick, and it's difficult to get out of it. But let me tell you something, even if it's how difficult, even if it seems impossible in the natural realm, God can still break any chain. He can cut off any link. He can break any chain in your life, irrespective of what. Now, the last thing is, I'm going to end off soon, is depression. I still got some minutes, Pastor Jimmy. I still got some minutes, 6:15, okay. Now, the one chain, the one problem in many people's lives is depression as well. I'm saying this because I sense there's some people with depression, yeah? Depression is also a horrible thing. It's a horrifying thing. It's like, I mean, you physically feel for nothing. You feel like life is sucked out of you. There's no reason to be happy. There's no joy. The devil has really attacked you. He attacked you piece by piece, little by little. He tries to steal your joy. Eventually until you have no joy. Right? And that's a devil's plan to destroy your life. Totally. Have you seen a depressed person? Even if you say what to that person, you will still see that person's mind is conditioned already to all the negativity. Because the devil is already like, put this chain around their minds. It only takes the power of God to break that. But it depends on the person. You have a willpower. With your own willpower, you must choose. And out of that painful situation, out of that heavy depression, you can still say, I want to be free. I want to give this up. I'm holding on to this depression too long. It's time for me to give it up and surrender to God. And if you do that, the power of God will break every chain. Break every chain in your life. Every chain. Every chain. Every chain. Every chain. Every chain. And tonight we're going to hear the clanging of these links and these chains. We're going to hear the shaking of chains as it will fall off you. In the spirit, we're going to hear that God will break these chains. The Holy Spirit will break these chains of your life, of your mind, of your soul, of your spirit. You know, we talk about soul ties, but I believe there are spirit ties too. There are spirit ties. When demons have a hold of your spirit, and your spirit and the demon spirit has a tie, God will have to break that tie. Amen. And we're going to hear the chains being shaken off. Amen. Yes, God's going to break these chains. You saw all these strong men, they couldn't even break this chain. I don't even think they moved anything on these links, never moved, you know, but these guys were strong. But it takes the power of God to break these chains in the spiritual realm. God is stronger. Amen? This is just in the natural. But I'm talking to give you kind of an idea. But in the spiritual, God breaks every chain. There's nothing too hard for God to do. He can break it like this. I saw it break. God break those chains in Romeo, like I said. And I told you how God protected me from even that thing. Even from a young child. The boys, like my cousins, like put ponytails and put ribbons on my head. And if you look at the pictures, you think it's a girl. But God kept me from that. God protected me from that. Can you see? God can protect you from these things. And if you've fallen in those areas, the power of God is still here to forgive and to heal you. Some of the root issues, you have to forgive your fathers. You have to forgive your mothers. The biggest percentage of demon problems is the unforgiveness towards parents. So it takes the power of God for us to deal with this issue. Okay, that last scripture, can you just go? Mark 3:27. Mark 3:27. That last scripture. Did I read that scripture? Mark 3:27. Let's just check that scripture out. Mark 3:27. Can they hear me? Okay. Leave that scripture. I want you all to stand up right now. Stand up, everybody. The power of God is here. You see, that scripture just basically says that you have to enter the strong man, enter his house, bind the strong man, and then spoil his goods. Same thing with demons. Whatever the strong man is, you have to bind that strong man and spoil the goods. So if it's hatred, you've got to bind that hatred. Self-hatred. Many of us hate ourselves. The Lord shows me there's 5 people in this church meeting that are bound to self-hatred. Let me explain that. You cut yourself. You cut yourself. There's 5 people, you cut yourself. That thing I can smell strongly in the spirit, because we deal with that a lot, my wife and myself, with people cutting themselves all the time. And we prayed for another girl too that stayed with us also. Also like a daughter. She cut herself 47 times. And when she came to us, God delivered her. It took a while. But God set her free, because we walked with her and believed in her. And God set her free. She had to forgive her dad. And God set her free totally. There are 5 people here who are cutting themselves. Don't embarrass you. You can come out and tell me individually, privately. Right? I'm going to make an altar call soon. So many people will come. And you can just whisper to me and tell me, I'm one of those people. And then I'll pray with you, okay? But God will set you free. Suicide, you're not contemplating that now, but you contemplated that early in the year. But for some other reason, you never dealt with it, and that thing has the potential to come and bite back. You have to also deal with that thing, right? That demon is following you, that spirit of death is following you, wants to kill you and take you out, right? Whatever problem you are facing now in your life. Whatever it is, if it's a medical condition, if it's a psychological condition, whatever issue, spiritual issue, whatever condition you might find yourself, I want to challenge you to come out tonight and to stand here in front. And the same God who broke the chains of his people throughout the decades, the same God who set many people free, the same God who broke all these chains, whether it's thin chains or thick chains, whatever it was, whether it's how many demons or you have, or maybe not even one demon, but you may be just oppressed or afflicted by demons on the outside, they're following you, you still need deliverance. And God wants to break that thing out. I'm not looking for demon under every bush and saying, yeah, you got demons, eh? If you all come up here, it means you got demons. No, no, no. I don't know about you, but if I have a problem in my life, I'm not going to be scared to say, please help me. All you got to do is admit and say, I need help. And tonight, even as you come forward, whatever addiction you might be having, it's time for you to give it to God now. Let's draw the line and say, enough is enough. I'm going to see God break the chains over my life. So wherever you are right now, please come quickly. I'm not going to waste my time, waste your time with this altar call. Please come right now. God is speaking to you. Come right now. Speak to the person next to you quickly and ask them, are you sure? Are you sure your life isn't where it is? Come, come, come. If your life is not at the place where it should be, please make sure. Ask the person next to you quickly and come, 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 come. Come, come, come. Come, come. Put your hands together. Just help these people. Help these people. Encourage them. Come, come, come. Come. Come, there's more, there's more. Come, come, come. Some of you need to forgive some people. Come, come. Some of you need to forgive some people. Come, 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 come. Some of you got anger towards your partners or towards your family members. Come, come. I just put this mic on, please. Pastor Jimmy's got a mic here. Come. I know there's more people. Come. Come right now, come. Okay, I'm going to ask you to do one more thing before we end the meeting. I'm going to hand over to Pastor Jimmy. Everyone in the church, you cannot afford to leave this place. Can you afford to leave this place? And someone is still sitting with shackles, and someone is still bound up, and you could have prevented it. I want you, before you even leave this place, I want you to ask the person on your left hand side and you ask the person on your right hand side, are you sure? Do you need to be up front? I will help you and take you by the hand and usher you here in front. Ask the person right now. Ask them, are you sure? Do you need to be here? I will help you. Ask the person next to you. Do it right now. Do it right now. Do it right now. Ask the person next to you. Quickly ask them. And if they're not sure, take them by the hand and say, come, let me help you. And usher you down the aisle and bring you to the front. Quickly. Bring them down. Quickly. Quickly. This is no jokes. This is serious stuff, huh? Serious stuff. Why do you think Pastor Jimmy is having these meetings on a Sunday, 5 and 7? Why? Some people think we're crazy. Just have one service on a Sunday. Listen, you know why we have all these services? Because we're giving people an opportunity to get set free. We're giving people an opportunity to experience Jesus. We're giving people to experience life instead of death.